Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Nimisha Jadhon from School of Studies Environmental Chemistry, Jivaji University, Gwalior. Today we are going to discuss here about the module Environmental Sampling and Analysis under the paper of Fundamentals of Analytical Chemistry. The learning objective of this module including the collecting the air sampler or the we can say the sample train or the sampling devices for the air sample and the collection of water sample there and then the collection of soil and the sediment sample and extracting trace organics from soil and water. First of all, we have discussed here about the environmental sampling. The environmental problems and their control receive a great deal of interest and publicity. This is a complex area, and while many advances have been made, much is yet to be learned concerning environment. Analytical chemistry play an important role in both defining and controlling environmental pollution. Some of the analytical techniques used to collect and analyze environmental samples are described here. First of all, we are discussing here about the collection of sample. Obtaining a representative sample is probably the most important step in environmental analysis. Environmental samples error often greatly exceed analytical procedural errors, and it was found in a survey, for example, that for geochemical samples, the analytical variance was only 0.1% of the total variance, while the sampling variance was 43% of the total, with 53% attributable to the actual geochemical variation. For reliable interpretation of chemical analysis, the combined sampling and analytical variance should not exceed 20% of the total variance. Sample inhomogeneity can be a problem of collecting the sample. The sampling concern and selected sampling procedure and the preparation for air, water and solid are described here in detail. But the first look at some generic sampling technique. The analysis of liquid and solid samples very often requires some forms of solvent extraction to isolate organic constituents. Conventional solvent extraction can be used and the pH may be adjusted to achieve some selectivity. For example, extracting from acid solution to prevent basic compounds from extracting. More efficient means of extraction are commonly employed today, such as microwave assisted or accelerated solvent extraction for solid sample. The methods for acid digestion for inorganic are given using a periodic table to select a particular element and a recommended acids or base. Some solid phase extraction is widely used for isolating the concentrating analytes prior to chromatographic measurement. Now, first of all, we will discuss here about the air sample collection and analysis. It was once thought that when a particular pollutant was admitted into the atmosphere, its chemical composition did not change and that an analysis of that pollutant would give an indication of the degree of contamination. However, it is now recognized that many chemicals undergo photochemical decomposition and the reaction in the atmosphere forming different pollutants that may be even more toxic than their precursors. The familiar smoke, for example, is generally considered related to the interaction of nitrogen oxide, hydrocarbons and sunlight. These factors point to the importance of proper sampling. Once the sample has been collected, any number of standard measurements techniques may be employed. Air is made up primarily of nitrogen, oxygen and argon, which comprise 99.9% of the dry air. There is a variable amount of water vapor and many minor and traces gaseous components as well as aerosols and the particulate species.
the sum of the atmospheric gases components of the environmental interest along with the representative concentration in the troposphere that we have discussed in the table, and the environmental effect may be quantitatively related to the mass concentration, and the concentrations may be reported as mass per unit volume, usually milligram per meter cube of air, under specific conditions of temperature and pressure. Aerosols and the particulates are reported in the same way. Here is the table of some important gases that are present in the environment and their relative measurement technique. The carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, and the methane is determined by the electrochemical technique or the gas chromatographic technique, and it is present approximately 100 ppb to 20 ppm concentration of carbon monoxide in atmosphere, then 345 ppm concentration of carbon dioxide and 2 ppm of methane respectively. Then the chlorofluorocarbons like CFCl3 or CF2Cl2 is also determined by gas chromatograph equipped with electron capture detector. And the hydrocarbons, oxides of nitrogen, determined by infrared techniques or either UV or chemiluminescence technique or the spectrophotometer or chemiluminescence technique. These oxides of nitrogen also determined by the gas chromatograph equipped with the electron capture detector. Then the ozone and the oxide of sulfur determined by UV visible and chemiluminescence method and the flame photometry or the spectroscope method. In environmental analysis, samples are generally collected for one of the several important reasons: to establish hazardous levels in the environment, to understand the chemistry of the environment, and to evaluate the efficiency of the environmental control measures or to determine the source of the pollutant. Hence, the mode of sampling can be important. The measurements will include monitoring ambient air emissions from industrial or the other processes and indoor air for specific toxic substances. Ambient air components will exhibit both short and long term changes. The urban ozone will undergo daily cycles, but stratospheric ozone varies seasonally and has been undergoing a long-term decline. The gases such as carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, and methane are exhibiting gradual increase of on the order of 0.8% per year. The industrial emission may be monitored as the gas leaves a stack or exhaust, where the concentration are much higher than when dispersed. The remote monitoring may be made to obtain an integrated measurement of emissions.
Now we discuss here about the size of sample. The volume of air sampled is governed by minimum chemical concentration that must be measured and sensitivity of measurement and information desired. Rate of sampling is vary with the sampling devices, and most of the sampling devices for gaseous constituents have flow rate of 0.03 to 0.03 meter cube per minute. Then the collection efficiency need not be 100% as long as it is reproducible and can be calibrated with the known standard. The all gaseous samples have threshold level below which their efficiency drops to near zero. The varies with sampling devices determined under the conditions used. Now, the next one is the duration of the sampling. The time of day and duration of the sampling will be determined by the information that is desired. The sampling period gives an indication of only average concentration during that period. It is more meaningful to sample city air samples during the rush hours and between the rush hours to obtain realistic indication of overall carbon monoxide exposure. Only a series of relatively short sampling time may reveal concentration that are known to be deleterious. A sampling device capable of efficient operation at high flow rate will be required for short sampling times. Now we come to the next point, that is sample storage. The storage of air samples should be kept to minimum. They should be protected from heat and sunlight. And care should be taken that desired test component does not react. The sampling train is the next parameter. It means the requirements for intermittent air sampling are vacuum source and the collector or the combination of collectors. An interval timer may be used to control time and duration of the sampling. The sampling device should be first unit in sampling train, followed by metering device and then vacuum pump.
Some of the more commonly used devices including vacuum source or metering devices. A vacuum source is used to draw sample through the collection device, motor or hand drive, vacuum pumps, aspirators and automobile vacuums are commonly used. In metering devices, flow measurement devices are of two general types, those that measure rate and those that measure the volume. The former are small and inexpensive but have the disadvantage of measuring only instantaneous rates of flow. So they must be checked frequently during the sampling period. The latter record the total flow passing through them and are therefore more useful. They are, however, bulkier and generally more expensive. A rotameter is a rate measuring device that consists of a spherical float within a tube that has a self-contained scale. The bore of the tube is tapered, being larger at the top, and the gas enters the bottom of the tube and the stainless steel float rises and falls in direct proportion to the rate of gas flow. In effect, a variable orifice is supplied. The scale is calibrated for the particular gas, for example air, whose flow is to be measured. The graphs are frequently made available with the meters for applying temperature or pressure correction, and the scale can be calibrated for measuring other gases. Here is the picture of rotameter to determine the rate measuring device. The dry test meter and the weight test gas meter are the volume measuring devices. A set of plastic bellows is alternatively filled and emptied, thereby driving the dial points via the system of bell cranks. Very little pressure is required. A thermometer and the manometer are provided with the meter for temperature and pressure correction. Dry test gas meters are useful for large volume measurement. The weight test meter is generally more accurate than the dry test meter for smaller volumes. The gas drives a rotor, which in turn drives the meter. The meter housing is partially filled with water through which the rotor turns. It is calibrated by the manufacturer at a given level of water. Sampling devices. The third component of the sampling train is the collector, which may be of variety of types depending on the particular application. The number one is the aerosol constituents. The one of the most commonly used means of collecting aerosol constituents is filtration. After collection on the filter, the aerosol content may be determined by weighing, by chemical analysis, or by particle sizing. Fiber filters like wood fiber, paper, glass fiber, granular filters, plated glass or metals, porous ceramic sand, and the membrane filter are used. The last is best for particle sizing. The most filters cannot be used at high temperature or the under moist condition, but some glass filter can be used at temperature up to 800 degrees centigrade. A second type of collection device for aerosol constituents is the impinger. This collects both solid and liquid aerosols. In dry impingers, also called impactors, and the aerosols impinge on a surface exposed to the air stream. The gasket impactor consists of a series of progressively small sized jets impinging at right angle on conventional microscope slide. Impactors are efficient for the collection of particles down to 2 micrometer in size. These impingers are well suited for collection of aerosol for microscopic examination. In wet sponges, the aerosol impinge on the surface submerged in a liquid. A glass tube with an orifice at the end is directed towards a flat surface, which can be the bottom of the collection vessel or a glass platform connected to the tube. The particles are retained by the liquid in the collection tube. The liquid should not be a solvent for the particles to be collected. These impingers can collect particles as small as 0.1 micrometer. More sophisticated collectors include electrostatic precipitators and thermal precipitators, which will collect particles down to 0.001 to 0.01 micrometer. The next one is the gaseous constituents. The gases and the vapors may be collected by absorption in a liquid or absorption on a solid surface, freezing or condensation, or filling an evacuated container. The distinction between the gases and the vapor is that the latter exist as liquids at ordinary temperature and can be easily condensed. Gas adsorption tubes are used to collect volatile organic compounds. A single sorbent or the multiple sorbents may be used in the tube. Once the analytes are collected, they can be extracted from the sorbent or thermally resorbed. Solid phase microextraction can be used for spot sampling of air by letting the fiber equilibrate with the air. If the fiber is contained within a needle, sample can be drawn over it for integral sampling. Headspace and purge and trap sampling can also be used. Air sample bags are convenient for sampling gases and vapors in which the analyte concentration is well above the detection limits of the measuring system. These are made up of Teflon and Tedler. The bag generally should not be filled more than 80% of the capacity. Collected samples should not be shipped by air unless in a pressurized cabin. The reduced barometer pressure could cause the bag to burst.
Now we discuss here about the air sample analysis. The most of the gases of environmental interest are chemically active and can be chemically or the physically measured. A gas analyzer can be made selective for the particular gas by appropriate wavelength selection. A method for determination of nitrogen dioxide involves absorption of nitrogen dioxide in a solution of sulfenilic acid. The total oxides of nitrogen, excluding the nitrous oxide, may be determined by collecting gas sample in flask containing an oxidizing absorbent of hydrogen peroxide in dilute sulfuric acid. The oxides of nitrogen are converted to nitric acid by absorbing solution, and resulting nitrate ion is reacted with phenol disulfonic acid.
From 5 to several thousand parts per million of oxides of nitrogen measured as nitrogen dioxide can be determined. The nitrogen dioxide may be reacted with luminol in alkaline solution to produce chemiluminescence with photon emission at 425 nanometer 30 ppt. Concentration of nitrogen dioxide may be detected. Nitric oxide can be measured by UV absorption. A highly sensitive and selective method is based on reaction of NO with O3, that is ozone, to produce an excited NO2 radical species that emits radiation in the range of 590 to 2600 nanometer range upon returning to the ground state. The nitrous oxide is the most abundant oxide of nitrogen in the atmosphere and can be measured by IR absorption or gas chromatography with electron capture detector. The ozone can be measured by UV absorption. If reacted with the it produces an excited CH2O radical species that emits a photon at 430 nanometer when returning to the ground state. 0.1 to 1000 ppb ozone can be measured by this technique. For the determination of sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere, the measured air sample is drawn through the solution of sodium tetrachloromercurate and the sulfur dioxide is absorbed by the formation of dichloro sulfato-mercurate complex ion. This complex resists oxidation by oxygen from the air and it reacts with the formaldehyde and para-rosaline in acid solution to form a para-rosaline methyl sulfonic acid, which is highly colored and absorbed at 560 nanometer. This method is sensitive and relatively free from interferences. Metal traces such as iron and manganese interfere, and if they are not removed as particulates by pre-filtration, their interference is eliminated by adding a chelating agent such as EDTA to the collection solution. As little as 0.003 ppm, sulfur dioxide can be measured in the atmosphere. A monitor of sulfur dioxide is based on flame photometric measurement using a fuel-rich air hydrogen flame. The total hydrocarbons in the air may be determined using infrared spectrophotometry, and the hydrocarbons are collected in a condensation trap immersed in liquid oxygen. Chlorofluorocarbons are chemically stable and are separated and measured at parts per trillion levels using gas chromatography with electron capture detector. Gases from emissions may be measured by placing sensors in the gas stream, or they may be measured spectrophotometrically by a light beam that transfers the exhaust gas and is reflected back to the detector. Extractive sampling may be done by inserting a sampling probe tube in the duct and pumping gas to the analyzer or sample collection device. Other analysis performed include the determination of acetylene, total aldehydes, ammonia, formaldehyde, formic acid, and total organic acids. Various aerosol fractions in the air are commonly analyzed.
Now we discuss here about the calibration of gas analyzers. Proper calibration of gas measuring device is critical. The gas mixtures of known composition must be prepared for the calibration purposes, and this can be done by the addition of gaseous components and the measuring weight. Or standards are prepared dynamically by dilution of concentrated standards of gas or mixture of gases into a stream of base gas. A stream of mixed gases results containing known concentrations of test gases. Dilution is accomplished by using either permeation or the diffusion tube. The test compound from the container permeates through membrane or diffuses along capillary. Permeation or diffusion rate depends on vapor pressure of compounds, temperature, membrane, and the geometry. The rate is determined by measuring weight loss from container over a period of time.
Now we discuss here about the water sample collection and analysis. Some of the many potential sources of water contaminants include industries such as petroleum industry, the iron and steel industry, paper and pulp industry, the coal industry, the chemistry, chemical industry and the food industry, in addition to the private source in the home and public and private sewage disposal. The land runoff, erosion and mine waste can be serious problems. This enumeration merely serves to point out the complexity involved in monitoring water purity. It is again apparent that water analysis involves a multitude of substances with a correspondingly large multitude of possible analytical methods. Government regulations required many industries to regularly monitor effluents or discharge. The next is sampling of water. There are several types of water matrices that are sampled and analyzed, including surface water like river, lakes and runoff water, groundwater and spring water, potable water, estuarine water, saline water, and the water from the atmosphere like rain flow, rainwater, snow, fog, dew, steam and process water. Some of these can be quite heterogeneous, either spatially or temporally. The sampling consideration will depend on the type of water sample. In general, samples may be obtained from faucet outlet at different points in pipe system, from the surface of rivers and lake waters, and at different depth. The most important consideration is that the frequency and the duration of the sampling be sufficient to obtain a representative and the reproducible sample. In some cases, composite samples may be used, in which individual samples taken at frequent interval are combined. The depth sampler are used to collect samples from large bodies of water at a specific depth. These contain some mechanism for removing a stopper after the bottle has been lowered to the desired depth. Commercial samplers are available from laboratory supply houses, and the sample to be shipped should have an airspace of 10 to 25 ml to allow room for expansion.
Now we discuss here about the groundwater samples. The groundwater is monitored by drilling a small well to access water. Before sampling, stagnant water is purged by drawing it out and allowing well to refill. The common devices for obtaining samples include submersible, peristaltic, then vacuum pumps, bladder pump, balers, and the dialysis membranes. Peristaltic pumps operate by multi-roller rotating head that squeezes a rubber tube, drawing fluid through tube. Then the pump tubing should be medical grade silicone rubber to avoid the organic peroxides found in other grades. Then the Teflon connecting tubing should be used if organics are to be analyzed.
Balers are used for sampling small diameter shallow wells. The disadvantage is that the bale tends to mix the sample, being prop particulates are collected from the well bottom. The sample may get aerated and the volatiles may get degassed in the open vessel. The baler may be modified with a bottom draw valve and it should be lowered slowly into the water. The sample should be analyzed as soon as after collection as possible for maximum accuracy. For certain constituents, the physical values, immediate analysis in the field is necessary to obtain the reliable results, because the composition of the sample may change before it arrives at the laboratory. Included are pH and temperature, and dissolved gases such as oxygen, hydrogen sulfide, and carbon dioxide. In certain cases, the gases may be fixed by reaction with the reagent, and the analysis is completed at the laboratory.
On-site monitoring devices are desirable for many analyses. Amperometric oxygen sensors are used to obtain immediate oxygen values. The automatic samplers and the instruments are used for regular monitoring. A flow injection apparatus can be controlled to automatically take sample at set intervals and to inject and measure it. Detection may be done by means of colorimetric consisting of a small flow cell and a LED source and detector.
The analysis of water samples. The problem of analyzing water samples is essentially no different from that of analyzing aqueous solutions in general. The measurements made include acidity or alkalinity, biochemical oxygen demand, carbon dioxide, chlorine, dissolved oxygen, electrical conductivity, fluoride, particulate and dissolved matter, ammonia, phosphate, nitrates, silica, sulfate, sulfide, turbidity, various metal ions, bacteria, microorganisms and so forth. Now we discuss here about the soil and sediment sampling. The sediments in contact with surface water vary seasonably by climate as flow changes and by depth. Many organic and inorganic constituents adsorb on sediment and the concentrations are much higher than in the water. The analysis of sediments is important for evaluating transport of trace constituents from the sediments to the overlying water and vice versa. Samples are usually obtained by dredging the bottom to obtain a grape sample or drill core samples are taken. The grape samples are easy to obtain and can be a large. The disadvantage is that only disturbed samples are collected and fine particles may be carried away by outflowing water. Core samples retain fine particles but they cover only a small area, so larger numbers of samples may have to be taken. The vertical integrity of layers in the sediments is maintained. The composite sediment samples are often used for the analysis. Core sediment samples are subsectioned and frozen for preservation prior to analysis. The core may be frozen first and then subsectioned. Sediment samples may be separated by particle size or by weight or dry sieving. They may be air dried or heated to dry, depending on the volatility of the analytes, followed by the grinding to add in extraction of analytes. The volatile analytes are extracted from weight samples. And for the trace metal analysis, samples are usually dry ash or weight digested. Surface soil are sampled for recent spills. If the constituents are volatile or extensive time has passed, then deeper samples may be required. Shallow samples 15 to 30 cm deep can be taken with scoops, towels or shovels. The stainless steel tools should be used when the sampling of organics and high density polyethylene for inorganic. A soil punch is better for taking reproducible samples by pushing into the soil to the desired depth. For sample deeper than about 30 cm, trenching may be done to obtain a profile, but this is usually costly. Augers, either hand operated or powdered, are often used or corers. The samples are taken from auger cuttings. A better approach is to auger to desired depth and then drive a soil probe into the soil. This retains the sample as it is withdrawn.
Now we discuss here about the sample preparation for trace organics. The determination of trace organic compounds in environmental samples requires getting them separated from the sample matrix. The common trace organics include the aliphatic and the aromatic hydrocarbons, aldehydes, phenols, chlorinated solvents, polychlorinated biphenyls, pesticides and phthalates. The water samples are extracted using water immiscible solvents in separatory funnel. and the polar solvents such as ethyl acetate or dimethyl ether are used to extract organic acids. Non-polar solvents such as hexane, cyclohexane are used to extract neutral lipids, aliphatic hydrocarbons and organopesticides. Then the solid phase extraction is increasingly used to separate and the pre-concentration of the trace organics from the wastewater sample.
Moist samples such as soils are usually dried in a vacuum oven and then ground. Before extraction, the samples are rehydrated by adding an aqueous buffer, which helps the transfer of analytes into a water-miscible extracting solvent such as acetone. The solid-solvent mixture is stirred or shaken and then filtered or centrifuged to separate the matrix. Typically, three extraction using small portions of solvents are needed to assure quantitative extraction. Heating may help in some cases, or ultrasonic energy can be used to increase efficiency. Continuous succinate extraction is often used. The solvent is continuously cycled through the sample by the distilling the solvent to a condenser centered over the thimble. The condenser solvent parameters through the matrix and the thimble and is siphoned back into the pot where it is recycled, and this is the basic principle of solvent extractor. The extracted material is concentrated in the pot. Analytes extracted from environmental samples are concentrated prior to measurement by evaporating the solvent using low temperature and reduced pressure for rapid solvent removal. Volatiles in soils and the sediments may be sampled directly using headspace analysis for gas chromatography. Once you have the extracted and the pre-concentrated organic analytes, you may have to perform additional cleanup, for example by running them through a column of adsorbent packing material such as silica or alumina. Then the chromatography is most often used for measurement. Pesticides are commonly determined by GC with electron capture detector or GC-MS. A non-polar capillary GC column is used, and trace PCBs and the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbon determination can be done by using HPLC with UV detector.
Now we discuss here about the contaminated land sites. Assessing extent of pollution in contaminated land site is one of the most commonly faced environmental problems. The sampling is critical to make proper assessment. Obviously, sample will be taken to represent the parts of site where the contamination is expected or where the contaminants are expected to be transported. The one should examine surface soil samples, core samples at various depth, runoff in nearby streams, rivers or the lake sediments, and vegetation from surface aquatic system and at land sites. Here we are discussing about the performance-based analysis. The Environmental Protection Agency EPA has published 100 of official methods for measurement of organic and the inorganic constituents in air, drinking water, wastewater, solid waste and and for pesticides and the toxic substances. For many years, analytes were required to use only EPA techniques when the performing regulatory analysis. This was true even if newer techniques and the methodologies exhibited superior performance in sensitivity, selectivity, speed or cost. The rules has been relaxed and laboratory may develop their own new methods and provide they meet the certain criteria. An acceptable level of performance is defined for particular analysis using criteria such as accuracy, precision, detection limit, specificity, sensitivity, robustness, and many more. If a laboratory can demonstrate that it meets the criteria, the method become an accepted one for the analysis of various contaminants of environmental sample. So at the end of this module, we can conclude it that the analytical chemistry is an important tier of environmental protection and has been traditionally linked to compliance and exposure monitoring activities for environmental contaminants. The adoption of the risk management paradigm has led to the special challenges for analytical chemistry applied to environmental risk analysis. So, in this module, we have learned about the various sampling techniques of soil, water, air contaminants. Thank you so much.